Okay, it's recording now. Okay, so in today's class, we shall continue lecturing about Trichostomugaile ID family. In the previous class also, we have discussed about one parasite that is, as I have said, one of the most important, Trichostomugaile ID family. Not only that, they are one of the most important parasites infecting livestock. Okay, in today's class, we'll have a brief recap about the general characteristic. As we know that these are small parasites, their mouthpart is reduced and there is no special characteristics. There is no special characteristics in their structures and in their morphology, mostly. Okay, so under this Trichostomugaile ID superfamily, we are having three family. One is Trichostomugaile ID, which are small gastrointestinal nematode, and generally they are regarded as GI nematodes. Okay, and another one is here in the last, we are having Dictyocolidae. These Dictyocolidae, they are generally known as lungworm. Okay, and Ollulandidae, this one is no longer in their course, so we will omit for now. So in the family Trichostomugaile ID, as we have discussed in the previous class, that they are devoid of the buccal capsule, and of course they are having well-developed bursa. They, as I told you, that they are small parasites, which are many of them, they are lesser than 1 centimeter in length. Some are usually on the average of male are usually 4 to 5 millimeter, and females are 5 to 7 millimeter, up to 8 millimeter in length. Okay, so they are usually, as I told you, that they are usually the parasite of gastrointestinal tract, and many times they are regarded as GI nematodes. Okay, then the tricho. Okay, here tricho literally means that it literally means hair. Okay, that means they are thin and they are slender and they are short. In the previous class, we have discussed about the parasites under Haemonchus and Mesistocerus. In today's class, we will just have a discussion regarding Trichostomugaile and Cooperia. And in the next class, we'll talk about Ostertagia. Most of the parasites in India, tropical parasites, they are Haemonchus, Mesistocerus, Trichostomugaile and Cooperia. Ostertagia and Nematodiras, they are parasites of temperate countries, okay, in Britain and in Northern Hemisphere, and even in India also, like in temperate land like Sikkim and Himachal Pradesh and all those higher up in Jammu and Kashmir. All those places, the parasites could be prevalent, but Nematodiras in India is prevalent only, means it is only found in Sikkim, not anywhere else. All right, so coming to the general characteristic, as we have said, that the parasite is devoid of buccal capsule. What is this? Here the parasite, they are, as we know, that they are having a small buccal capsule. We know that. That is for the case of Haemonchus contortus. And you see that there is a presence of a small buccal capsule. But in generally, the parasites under Trichostomugaile ID, they are not having a buccal capsule. Okay. In case of Strongyle ID, the parasite, if you see that they are having a wide open buccal capsule, so as in the case of Ankylostoma, they are having a wide buccal capsule. But if you look back further than that, in case of Ascaris, there is no buccal capsule. Okay, here also they are having devoid of buccal capsule, but unlike Ascaris, which are very, very large parasite, they could be up to 1 foot. More than 1 foot, and these parasites are small, as I told you, they are up to 5 millimeter in length, and they, unlike Ascaris, they do not have a special organization of the lip. In case of Ascaris, we know that there are three presence of three lips. Okay, here The characteristic is that there is presence of excretory notch, excretory pore in the anterior region, which is known as excretory notch. Okay, and the parasite is having, these are a small parasite, they are up to 5 millimeter in length on an average. Male will be lesser than 5 millimeter in length, 4 to 5 millimeter, and whereas female would be around 5, 6, 7, 8 millimeter in length maximum. Okay, so how does the parasite cause pathogenesis? That is what intriguing it is. They are small parasites. Well, how does? Because they are, due to their small in size, they form a tunnel in the epithelium between the epithelial cells and the basement membrane of the intestine or abomasum or wherever they locate. In case of hemuncus, of course, they cause pathogenesis by drawing blood, by their feeding nature of blood. But here in this case, Ribostrongylus and Ostertagia cooperi and most of the parasites, they form a tunnel, or because of their presence in the intestinal epithelium or gastric epithelium, they cause pathogenesis. That is one thing you must keep in mind. Okay, so in Ribostrongylus, I'm just pointing out two species only. There are 6, 7, 8 species: Ribostrongylus colubriformis, Ribostrongylus eggsi, rugosus, and longis specularis, and retortiformis, and all this. But for you, for undergraduate, I'm just pointing out two. One is Ribostrongylus eggsi, and another one is Ribostrongylus colubriformis. These two are the most important one. If we have, if you guys are here in the campus, we could have shown you we could have cut open the small intestine or the abomasum of goat or sheep, and then we may, maybe we can observe on live, but now we are facing this pandemic. So anyway, let's try to cope up with. Here, Ribostrongylus eggsi, one of the most important one, they are locating in the abomasum of sheep and goat, that means in the ruminants, whereas in case of horse, they are locating in the anterior portion of the small intestine, or sometimes they also locate in the gastric, in the stomach, okay, in case of horse. Here, the characteristic of Ribostrongylus eggsi is that the egg orientation or the placement of the egg inside the uterus is pole-to-pole arrangement. Okay, here, pole-to-pole arrangement. Here, if you see here, this is the egg inside the uterus. Okay, the egg, they are arranged one egg. That means that their longitudinal axis is in line. Okay, whereas in case of Ribostrongylus colubriformis, they will be, this is one egg, and there will be another egg like this. All the eggs are in side-to-side arrangement inside the uterus. Of course, this is visible in live specimen also. Okay, because they are very thin parasites, they are small parasites. With a light microscope, we can visibly, very clearly observe it. Okay, here I'm repeating, in case of Ribostrongylus eggsi, the eggs are arranged in pole-to-pole. That means end-to-end, from anterior end to posterior end, they are arranging serially. Whereas in case of Ribostrongylus colubriformis, which is also another parasite, that is the parasite, they are arranged in side to side. All right. Of course, these parasites, many a times that they cause co-infections. Okay, you might not find in a single animal, there could be Ribostrongylus eggsi as well as Ribostrongylus colubriformis infections. Both can be found in a single animal. Okay. Life cycle, just like the previous one, simple as that. Typical Strongylus life cycle, the egg which laid out in the environment is hatched out into larva 1, larva 2, larva 3, larva 3 find its opportunity to climb up to the grass blades, and in the morning or in the evening when the sun ray is not that strong, then they will enter on the definitive host to ingestion. Okay, so this is a simple life cycle. Of course, they are having a typical or unique. This beauty of it, sound. Who is that? Okay, so now comes the most important one, the pathogenesis. Okay, so the pathogenesis, I am just summarizing into four pathogenesis. One is the production of catarrhal inflammatory conditions. Number two is protein losing gastroenteropathy. And the next will be anorexia, and there will be depression in the growth rate. We will see one by one in detail. Okay, so as I told you, the pathogenesis of Trichostrongyl lidii family, most of them, especially Trichostrongylus, is due to formation of a tunnel beneath the epithelium cell, beneath the epithelial cells, they will be forming a tunnel. Okay, that will invite catarrhal inflammatory conditions. All right, so due to that conditions, there will be subsequent pathogenesis that we will discuss right now. Okay, there is one lesion, a typical lesion known as ringworm lesion, which is in the abomasum. We can see that there will be a grayish flat area, which is sharply demarcated from the surrounding areas. This is known as ringworm lesion. This is specifically caused by Trichostrongylus XZ. Okay. The next is due to the parasites presence in the in the epithelial cells. I'm getting disturbance. Your friend, who or he's out, not in the home, he's playing songs and maybe he's unaware of that. He's putting on the mic. Anyway, due to the presence of parasites in the intestinal, in the tunnel, in the gastrointestinal tract, there will be thickening of the lamina propria due to inflammatory conditions, and there will be increase in the capillaries, permeability of the capillaries. There will be, because due to inflammatory conditions and all these subsequent events, the tight junctions between the epithelial cells. Okay, the tight junction between the epithelial cells is not maintained. Okay, so from that losing of the tight junction, there will be leakage of plasma proteins, mostly albumin, that will be leaking out from blood vascular system into the intestinal lumen. So what will happen if there is continuous losing of the proteins into the gastrointestinal tract? There will be hypoalbuminemia, and ultimately it will develop into hypoproteinemia. Okay, so this is quite detrimental for the animal. Okay, in the next, due to the presence of the parasites in the intestinal tract and in the gastric mucosa, so there will be secretion of cholecystokinins, CCK, which works on the hunger center, then subsequently will cause inappetence, or ultimately, if it is severe, they will cause anorexic conditions. In total, there could be up to 20% reduction in the food intake, or further than that also, because the parasites will be anorexia, there will be low feed consumption. Okay, and the next one will be, there will be disturbance or alterations in the intestinal epithelium or intestinal villi. So there will be villus atrophy, or there will be destructions of the intestinal villi, and ultimately, the enzymes secreted by the intestinal villi will be disturbed, and the absorptive surface of the intestinal villi also is disturbed. And ultimately, what it will affect, there will be decreased absorption of the nutrients. And when there will be decreased absorption of the nutrients, there will be decrease in growth, especially of the bone, and there will be osteoporosis, and there will be the animal will be fragile to breakage of bone or fracture due to hypoproteinemic conditions. As it was caused earlier by protein losing gastroenteropathy, what will happen? The body try to maintain the homeostasis. So when the body try to maintain the homeostasis, what will happen? They will increase the liver protein synthesis. What is liver protein synthesis? That means there will be increase in the synthesis of albumins, of the plasma proteins. Okay, at the same time, there will be reductions because all the energy or all the resources will be used up for synthesizing the albumin. So ultimately, there will be no more proteins or no more resources for synthesize for muscular growth. And what will it ultimately affect? It will affect in resulting in the poor growth, number one, resulting in the poor wool growth, resulting in the skeletal growth or the muscular growth, then resulting in the poor milk yield or whatever performance it is. Economically, it will be unstable here. Okay, so the animal will be at all not economical at this point. So I'm repeating here that there will be gastrointestinal inflammations, which is caused by due to the formation of the tunnel beneath the epithelial cells, and there will be protein losing gastroenteropathy, and then what will happen due to the protein losing gastroenteropathy, then what will happen is that the plasma proteins will be leaking out in the from blood vascular system through the intestinal lumen. And what will happen? So when there will be losing of plasma protein, there will be hypoalbuminemia or hypoproteinemia. And when the body tries to cope up with hypoalbuminemia or hypoproteinemia, all the energy or all the resources are used up for synthesizing the plasma proteins, and there will be no more resources left for muscular growth. And at the same time, there will be a decrease in hunger, means suppression of the hunger center, and there will be inappetence or anorexic conditions. All right, so the next parasite that I will talk about is just one slide only I'm putting here. That is Cooperia, which is, these are a group of parasites, which Cooperia cartesi, Cooperia pectinata, Cooperia punctata, and these are mostly infecting large ruminant. Of course, Cooperia cartesi is infecting small ruminants. There is no special characteristic regarding to this parasite, except that the anterior portion is transversely striated, and the spicules, which is the male copulatory organ, the spicule is having a wing-like expansion at the middle portion. Okay, the spicule is having a wing-like expansion at the middle, and just like Haemonchus contortus, there will be presence of vulval flap, which is covering the female genital opening. Okay, in India, one of the most important one is that here comes, I mark in red, that Paracuperia nodulosa, which is the nodular worm of buffalo calf. Okay, of course, the nodular worm of sheep and goat is Isovogastomum colombianum. Okay, but here in this case, in case of buffalo calf, it is Paracuperia nodulosa. I'm going to ask this one in exam, please note it down. Clinical manifestation and understanding the pathogenesis makes us understand the clinical manifestation. We can expect what will be the manifestation. There will be anorexia, there will be emaciation, there will be anemic conditions. And particularly in case of Trichostrongylus xzi, there will be black scoring. So the parasite is generally known as black score worm. Please mark it. I'm going to ask this one as an exam. Black score worm is not Trichostrongylus colubriformis. It is Trichostrongylus xzi. So diagnosis, simple as that. That means just like other the other parasites of Trichostrongylidae, history, clinical signs and symptoms, this will all be important fecal examination. Because based on fecal examination, it is really difficult to rule out which species exactly it is, because all the eggs are similar. there is no point of distinguishing from Trichostomgalus from Hemoncratus, Hemoncus contortus, or Trichostomgalus from Cuperia. There is nobody can differentiate amongst them. Okay, so it is we generally say strongyle parasites. That much only. Okay, here in this case, of course, nowadays scientists are trying to develop ELISA for specific diagnostic tests, ELISA test for dot ELISA test using cysteine proteinase or whatever proteins the protein derived from the parasites, and postmortem examinations, we can see the ringworm lesions and in case of horse, of course, there will be hypertrophy of the gastric intestinal epithelium. There will be pedunculated lesion, that means like large polypoid lesions can be found in case of horse. And apart from that one, there is not significant pathognomic lesions, but the parasites can be found in the gastric tunnel beneath the intestinal epithelium. Okay, this much only for today's class. Thank you. If you have any doubt, let me know.